We need that. Usually, when we produce a scientific, let's say, account, it is seamless. So we need to disrupt this authority and show how it is. It is not a. What should I say?
Unity.
Yes, it is. It is. Anyway, that we need to disrupt this authority. Now, I think using the research, the experience of the researcher is a way to do that, but not in order to say, this is what I am suffering from, or this is what it means to me, but using the experience, trying to understand that experience not as a personal, internal issue, but as something that is happening in relation to someone else. And the fact that it is happening indicates that indicates the dynamic of that relationship, rather than something that is happening to me. So I had in mind to talk about three case studies as examples of activist research. And the one is research on gender and migration in the anti-racist movement in Athens, which is my PhD. The other is a case study that has to do with an event that happened in December 2008. A migrant woman called Kostandina Kuneva, a Bulgarian migrant woman working as a cleaner in Athens, was attacked by an unknown man on the street. Vitriolic acid was thrown on her face, and she was left there. She was then taken to the hospital, and this was because she was an active union member, and she was protesting against various forms of exploitation that cleaners face in Greece by the private businesses that employ them. So this was an act of revenge on the part of the employers. And then there was a whole movement that developed, solidarity movement that developed towards Kostandina Kuneva. And it's considering what happened there. And the third case study is researching intercultural education, again, in Greece. I think I'll go with the first. And maybe just say one or two key points for the second and the third. So I'll just say these key points for the second and the third, and then I'll go in more detail in the first. Now, what happened with Kostandina Kuneva and the solidarity movement that developed? The solidarity movement developed, she was part of the cleaners' union. The cleaners' union consisted of Greek and migrant women cleaners who work in private companies. These private companies are used by state agencies to clean different state properties. But they are not employed by the state directly. So there is outsourcing. The state outsources the cleaning to these private companies who then employ Greek and migrant, but mostly migrant women, and some of them illegal migrant women, under very, very bad exploitative conditions. So, and she was a union member, and she was actively fighting this. So she was disciplined through this attack. And the solidarity movement that developed was mainly by union, other union activists and other unions. So there was a huge kind of union discourse that developed. And the other part was the feminist groups. So these two, and then also a third part, the anti-racist groups. And what happened was that each one of these social and political movements, or let's say sectors, appropriated her in terms of one identity. So for the union, for the unionists, she was an exploited worker. They didn't care if she was a migrant and a woman, but she was an exploited worker, and this is what they foregrounded. For the feminists, she was basically an exploited woman, and a woman that, you know, in the long history of women who have been attacked and exploited, you know, she was the last example. And then for the anti-racist movement, she was mainly a migrant. So none of these solidarity movements and discourses could apprehend her in her intersectionality, that she was a woman and a migrant and a cleaner and a mother and many different other things. The result of that is that at some point the cleaning union, of which she was a member, decided that what they wanted to request, demand from the Greek government was that all women who work for cleaning companies, that women who work for cleaning companies, private cleaning companies, get regular contracts. This was their, they came up with this kind of demand and slogan. We want you to, not legalize, what do you call it?
Regularize
women cleaners. And in doing, in saying this, they did not, they had the support of the unions, they had the support of the feminist movement, but in doing this, they were not taking into account that if, that demanding the regularization of their work as women only, without putting the migrant identity into the picture, would leave, let's say, 70% of the women who work as cleaners out of this arrangement, because migrant women from non-European countries cannot sign a legal contract, a civil contract. They said, we want to have the status of civil servants. We want to be regularized as civil servants. But that meant that by default, this demand excluded the migrant women from non-EU countries, whether they were legal or illegal, it excluded them. And this then, because the union, the cleaners union, comprised of 70% migrant women, this created a huge conflict within the cleaners union, because the migrant women said, yes, well, this is a very good arrangement for you, but what about us? So this, it created a split, and then they went through a period of a lot of negotiations between them, very intense, and they actually came up with another, with a different demand, which said that we want regularization, work, what do you call it, labor, let's say, regularization and security for all women, migrant and Greek women. And this was a more inclusive demand. And actually this demand created a new, let's say created a new, could be seen as a kind of citizenship practice. In other words, they were constructing, in articulating this demand and saying that migrant women, even though the Greek state does not recognize them as deserving subjects, that migrant women should have the same rights as those of us who are legal citizens in their labor arrangements. So in doing that, they were creating a new position for a new citizenship. So this was a case of what I would call alliance or a kind of materialization of alliance or transversal politics, and an act of citizenship. They created a new subject, let's say, position, which was not the Greek or the migrant woman, but a more inclusive subject position. So this is just a little bit about the Huneva. Okay, and very briefly about the school. This is a school that I worked in, and it's a primary school in the center of Athens, in a very downgraded area, and this school has something like an 80% migrant, 70% migrant population. So there are 70% migrants and 30% Greeks, Greek students, and most of the migrant students are Albanians. So it's a school where the teachers take great pride that they are anti-racist educators, and that they try to practice anti-racism in their classrooms every day. So when I went to the school, I could not tell the Albanian and the Greek children apart. So I couldn't tell, let's say, from language or other cues, if a child was an Albanian child or a Greek child. They all seemed Greek to me. So in this school, and the teachers themselves said, oh, we're a very happy school community here. We're very happy because we don't have conflicts, and we have learned to live together, and we don't separate between Greek and migrant children. Therefore, you can't tell the Albanian kids from the Greek kids. Now, to my mind, this entailed also a certain kind of assimilationist tendency, in the sense that the Albanian children were very happily integrated as Greek children, nominal Greek children. But there was no Albanian presence in the school in the sense of an Albanian history, an Albanian language, not necessarily in order to separate the Albanians from the Greeks, but construct the Albanian cultural, let's say, or historical aspect as a resource for the school. That it was, as we are learning Greek, we're also learning Albanian, because we are a Greek-Albanian school, and therefore both of these cultures are relevant to us. So they had been Greekified, the Albanian students, right? And into this school now come a fairly large group, 20, so the school had about 100 students, and at some point, 20 students, and these were boys specifically from Afghanistan, refugee children, came to the school. And after these refugee children came to the school stopped being this really lovely place where everybody got along together and started registering a lot of conflict and fights. And then there was this whole discourse that developed that these Afghan children, they are very, very violent. They're very violent because they come from a war-torn region. Because they have experienced the war, now they come here and they recreate the war. And also, they also probably are more violent in their families because they're more traditional and the men beat the women. And, this kind of explanation, which was put forward as an attempt to actually, as a benevolent attempt, actually, to explain why there are conflicts in the school. Rather, so they didn't think, they considered this to be within their anti-racist, let's say, commitment to offer this kind of, to mobilize this kind of explanation. And I'm not going to try and analyze it, but there is a very, very interesting quote by Sara Ahmed that I think really kind of throws light on this, on what is happening there. Where is the quote? Okay, there it is. She says, some bodies, this is in an article where she is discussing feminism as killing joy, and why this kind of project of happiness is a repressive, let's say, political agenda. And she says, some bodies are presumed to be the origin of bad feeling, right? The Afghan children, the Afghan bodies in the school, insofar as they disturb the promise of happiness. Which is the promise of happiness? That we are all together a great little, you know, happy community. Greeks and Albanians, there's nothing separating us as long as the Albanians assimilate and are not different. So when the other appears who is really different, it creates a sense of disease, which I re-describe as the social pressure to maintain the signs of getting along. They disturb this promise of happiness. We could describe such bodies as blockage points, points where the smooth communication stops. And for me, clearly, the Afghan refugee children were these kinds of blockage points in this narrative of you know, finding an anti-racist narrative of finding a way of getting along together, kind of multicultural, whatever happens. So now I want to talk a little bit more about my PhD research. Yes. And some of the issues that came up and that I'm still struggling with. Now, I decided that I wanted to research how migrants in Greece are changing the social and the political context. And I wanted to find out, and obviously they were changing the kind of economic and social relations because they were, there were migrant stores in neighborhoods, they were living amongst us, Greek businesses would employ migrant workers, so their social presence was very obvious and documented, but their political presence was not. So I was interested in whether migrants, how they enter Greek politics, so to speak. Now already, I will try to do this kind of reflexive analysis at the same time. Already this question, in this question, there is this assumption, I am looking from the eyes of a Greek. I'm not looking at migration in Greece from the eyes of a migrant. I'm looking at it from the eyes of a Greek, and I'm saying, oh, how is Greece, my country, changing? So just to highlight this aspect, which is very important, because in migration research, one of the issues that one has to address is what is called methodological nationalism, that migration is always researched from the perspective, the point of view of the nation state. What does it do to the nation state? Does it help the nation state? Is it bad for the nation state? How does it change the nation state? So it's always this perspective. So me too. I mean, it is so dominant that I am not even though I am this, you know, anti-racist, blah, 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 I am not aware of it. So I start my research from this position. The second thing that drives me is that I feel very uncomfortable about approaching migrants, let's say, and asking them for interviews or things like that. So I decide that I would rather engage with them. So I don't want to approach migrants and ask them about their political, let's say, involvement. I want to do something, engage in common and indirect action. So it won't appear as if I too am exploiting them, because I'm using them for my benefit. Now again, here there are a lot of issues, right? The one is, what is this issue of the distance that I feel between myself and the migrants? You know, what produces this distance? And at this point, I mean, and let's say again, from a critical perspective, I would have to challenge the kinds of discourses that construct this difference as an aspect of cultural, let's say, difference, and look at this difference, this distance, as an aspect of class distance, as an aspect of let's say, labor distance. In other words, the kinds of relationships, the kinds of relations that minimize difference between Greeks and migrants are particular kinds of labor relations. You know, when you employ a migrant woman to come and clean your house or take care of your mother or your father or your children, that is a sanctioned lessening of distance. But otherwise, the migrant woman in Greece is the other. So I don't feel that I am either capable or, I mean, the fact that this otherness, I am experiencing it as an emotional block. I'm trying to move now between different registers, you know, kind of the emotional aspect and the more structural aspect. So this emotional block that I'm feeling, my fear of approaching migrants, you know, and asking them for an interview, is not an issue of my psychology. That's what I'm trying to say. It's an issue of the structural relation, the kind of structural positions that we are locked in. Okay, so what did I do? I went to an anti-racist group that I knew because I had worked with them in the past, and it's also the most important anti-racist group in Athens. And I joined the group, I became a member of the group, and I decided, okay, I'm going to research this political relationship as a group within an anti-racist group doing anti-racist activism with migrants, with Greek and migrant activists. So I joined the group, and it was very obvious, because of the group's history and the history of anti-racism in Greece, that there were very, let's say, important gender and sexism issues being played out. Because this anti-racist group is a leftist group, and because anti-racism in Athens has developed as a leftist, as a movement out of the left. And so it bears the marks of left politics, and left politics in Greece as as elsewhere, which is you know, identified as class politics, is also masculinist politics. So I encountered the same kinds of discriminations within this anti-racist group. And this means that it was always men who were, you know, made the important political decisions. It was men who articulated the political agendas and the conceptualizations of migration. And Greek women were, and there was a kind of hierarchy. So there were Greek men on top. Then Greek women were supposed to follow Greek men, but also instruct instruct men and women migrants. So Greek women had a higher position than men migrants. I mean, the people who were at the lowest position were women migrants. The women migrants were assumed that, and this was specifically said to us, they were assumed not to understand the political issue and not to be able to articulate their experience in political terms. So we were told by a migrant male activist that you will have to guide migrant women to become politically active and thinking subjects, right? So this is the kind of general context I find myself in. And
I'm sorry, but you have to finish.
Okay.
So say what you want to say,
okay. So anyway, yes, sorry. So,
I'm sorry.
Yes, no, it's true. So what I did is I found two or three other women, Greek and migrant women, and we started what we called a gender and migration initiative. And this within the anti-racist group, okay? So we said, we are going to work on gender and migration. And we started contacting other migrant women and migrant women's organizations and migrant communities. And obviously, I mean, there was no lack of political agency in migrant women. It was very clear. But the interesting thing, the important thing is that this gender and migration initiative started out with three Greek women and one woman from Sierra Leone, a black woman from Sierra Leone. And after 2 months of working together, and as I said, we were all very, you know, committed to this. And we wanted to do our best. And after 3 months, the woman from Sierra Leone silently disappeared from our group because we excluded and marginalized her. And one of the ways that we marginalized her was by assuming our white position to be a normative, to be an unmarked position. I mean, by not bringing color in as an aspect of racism in migration. So we wanted to be colorblind, right? But this created a condition of exclusion for that black woman. And so this was this, and then anyway, we went on and did different, you know, organized different activities and public presentations and all that with other white migrant women, you know. The point is that what I was doing while this all was happening, I was being an activist, but as simultaneously a researcher, I was recording all this that was happening. So then I went back and I thought, okay, and not even then, you know, during the process, I thought, okay, what is happening here? This is why it is like, how can I say this? A researcher position is very useful to an activist position, to an activist, because actually, in some sense, we should have stopped at that point and said, what is it that we're doing? You know, what is it that we're doing that produces this exclusion, this marginalization, without even realizing that it is happening? And rather than go on and do what anti-racist activists usually do, to actually practice anti-racist activism by sitting with this situation and trying to understand it more. So this is how the one can feed the other, and that's it. And just one last point, that the way, I mean, it isn't necessarily the way to bring in racialization, the structures of racialization based on this experience we had, is not necessarily by looking at, let's say, racism against blacks, because there might not be this particular investment present. There may not be racism against blacks, but there always is white privilege. So you can address the issue of racialization by addressing and bringing in, by marking your position, by bringing in the issue of white privilege, which will allow then the black person to talk about their experience of marginalization. Thank you very much. And,